Hachette Audio presents The Less Dead, written by Denise Mina, read by Katie Leung.
Chapter 1. Hope dies slowly, but it does die. Even though it's obvious that Margo Dunlop has been stood up, she can't seem to make herself leave. She's a doctor and well knows how stubborn and pernicious hope can be. Without confirmation, in the absence of direct contradiction, hope will linger long beyond the point of being useful. The speed of death is often determined by the degree of initial investment. She has been waiting for an hour and 40 minutes, alone in this odd-shaped room, listening for the lift and staring at the back of the door, willing it to open and change her life. She has come to meet her birth family for the first time. Not her birth mother, though. It turns out that Susan died a long time ago. How wasn't specified in the contact letters, but Margot very much needs to know. She's a doctor. She's pregnant and afraid of her own genetic legacy. She has suspicions. She's too invested. She shouldn't have come here. She should have been more careful. The birth family are very late. Deep down, Margot knows that they're probably not coming now, but she's trying not to get angry. She's still clinging to an outside possibility that they have a good reason for being late. A train crash or a stopped watch, as if that still happens. If they turn up late and blameless, she doesn't want the meeting to turn into a fight about punctuality. There are questions she needs answered. She's waiting in a room at the top of an old office block in the heart of Glasgow, just off George Square. It's hot and smells weird, as if something is rotting deep in the fabric of the building. The adoption charity have tried to make the room homely, but the furnishings are cheap and somehow ominous, like a police reconstruction of a family sitting room where something dreadful happened. There's a sagging sofa with a low back, a coffee table with a box of tissues on it, and a dining room chair. An IKEA bookcase holds torn children's books and a sticky game of Hungry Hungry Hippos with no balls. She's been here long enough to look. The shape of the room bothers her too. It's square with a low ceiling of glass squares, all painted opaque with white emulsion. She thinks the inside of the building has been gutted and modernised, and this must have been the top of a grand old staircase. That what she's sitting under is the old skylight. Thinking about it makes her feel the void beneath her and her shin bones tingle like a memory of falling. Margot found the contact letters from Nikki hidden deep in a drawer in her mum's bedside table. The first was dated several years back, the latest just a few months ago. They were addressed to Margot, care of Jeanette, and asked Margot to please write back. Nikki said she was desperate to see her because she really needs Margot's help with something. Jeanette was dying and rarely conscious when Margot found the bundle of letters. She has tried to understand why Jeanette didn't pass them on. Nikki did sound mad. All that stuff about Glasgow's Jack the Ripper hunting her for 30 years. But Margot is less interested in the substance of her delusions than the tone. Margot's not entirely sure of her own mental health. She wants to know if Nikki was schizotypal, if there was a genetic likelihood of her getting it. But Nikki's not coming. Margot looks at the back of the little door to the room and imagines what she would look like to a stranger walking in. She's tall and the ceiling is low. Her hands are on her knees, feet are flat on the floor. She'd look intimidating and monumental, like a statue of Queen Victoria discovered in a crate. She attempts a welcoming smile, but tension instantly warps it into a growl. But no one's coming anyway. She drops the scary smile and lets her face idle and neutral. No one. She picks up her coat from the settee and sits it on her knee. A first move towards putting it on. Now she'll never know what happened to Susan, or if she gets her height from her, if she's mixed race. Her hair says yes, but her skin tone says no. She won't get to ask anything. No one is coming. So bloody rude. Selfish. What kind of people agree to a meeting this emotionally charged, pick the place and the time, and then don't turn up? She checks the time on her phone. It's 1:50 now. She's on an indignant roll but gets distracted by an unanswered text from an hour ago. Her best friend Lila asked, "How about now, Lamb Chop?" Anything yet? Margo still hasn't replied. She kept hoping to have a better answer. A very careful knock is followed by the little door being opened. It's Tracy, the counsellor who gave Margo a long talk about limiting her expectations on the way in. Margo dislikes Tracy for reasons that she can't quite fathom. Maybe it's the tent situation. Maybe it's Tracy's belligerent walk. She sways her shoulders and enters the room belly first as if she's pregnant and wants to talk about it, or is fat and doesn't. She has thick glasses that distort her big green eyes and wears a dress with a low neckline displaying 4 inches of cleavage. A gold chain with a green pendant surfs her record-breakingly long boobs, bobbing around, going under sometimes only to be unthinkingly fished out by Tracy's chubby forefinger. "Hello again," she whispers as she comes in, head tilted sympathetically, lips pressed tight in a very sad sorry as she sits on the sofa and clasps her hands together. She's going to tell Margo to give up and get out. She'll dress it up, but that's what she'll mean. Tracy doesn't get to speak before Margo blurts that she'll just wait for another half hour, if that's okay. "We'll see now," drawls Tracy in a breathy Northern Irish accent that sounds like a melancholy old song. "The problem with that is we're supposed to actually shut the office in a wee 10 minutes. I sort of just wanted to have a wee chat with you before that happened, so that you don't leave feeling that you might have liked to have talked to someone. Would you maybe like a wee chat about it? About your feelings?" Every sentence ends in a tonal upswing. Every statement is littered with infuriating conditionals, maybes and minimizations and perhapses. But Margo is a doctor and has been on the receiving end of enough impotent rage from patients to know that Tracy isn't to blame for how she feels. "I'll just wait on for the last 10 minutes, if you don't mind." Margo says it softly, overcompensating for her white-hot fury. "At least then I'll know for sure that Nikki didn't come. It's just 10 minutes. I may as well."
"Ah, yeah. May as well. Grand, grand. May as well."
Tracy pats her own knee while looking at Margot's.
"You don't owe them anything, you know. You've given them a good long time to get here. You've done what you can. You don't have to wait."
Margot doesn't know why Tracy is using the plural. Is she being formal? Or does Tracy know something Margot doesn't? Is Nikki trans? Or has Margot just been stood up by several people? Is that better or worse? "Well, I'll wait for the 10 minutes.
"Sure.
If that's all right." Tracy nods and smiles vaguely. She air rescues the green stone from the ravine of her cleavage but doesn't move to leave. She's trying to be kind, waiting with her and giving Margot space to talk about her feelings if she wants to. Margot doesn't trust her. What Margot does say is that it's very quiet in the office. Is it always like this? Tracy tells her that, to be honest about it, they don't really do reconciliation mediation very much anymore. They used to, but people tend to trace their birth families on Facebook. She wouldn't recommend that. That can go very, very wrong. Being stood up isn't the worst, believe you her. You've no idea, honestly. Margo was still clinging to the faintest possibility of car crashes or excitement-induced heart attacks, but Tracy knows no one is coming. She works here. She's seen it all before. Margo is suddenly so angry that she feels sick, and Tracy sees that. She reaches over and squeezes Margo's hand pityingly, which makes it worse. Margo puts her own hand over Tracy's and squeezes back, maybe a little too hard, and begins to rage cry. Lila calls this the ugliest cry of all. Tracy says kind things. "Listen, you, to her now. You're all right now. It could be worse." Margo yodels. What could possibly be worse than this? Tracy talks softly. "This is not the worst I've seen, not by a long way. It can go very wrong, especially if there isn't a mediator. The state of some of them. Wouldn't you look in the mirror and wash your hair? They've had some right arseholes in here." Tracy's being a lot more frank than she was on the way in. "It can be dreadful and she should know because she's been through this herself. Oh yeah, and that is why she works here as a volunteer, because of her own terrible, terrible experience." She looks at Margo, waiting for a prompt, but Margo doesn't care what happened to Tracy. This is happening to her right now and she's overwhelmed. It takes a moment for Tracy to realise that she isn't going to ask about it. She blinks, shuts that box of horrors and moves on, talking in abstracts. When people meet on the internet...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.